Hi, Larry.
Hi, Sydney.
Well, I would say, given that beautiful introduction from Marcy Glazer, that we are at the right place at the right time to be sitting here with you.
You stole my line.
And it's an extraordinary honor. We had a beautiful conversation as I was about three quarters of the way through the book, Sometimes Brilliant. And I have to say, I'm always amazed when I see people reading books today. And this is a very exceptional and special autobiography. And when I say three quarters of the way, it took me another 3 days to get through it. It was so brilliantly written, and I feel like it's a story that needed to be told. So my first question for you is, you shared with me that it took you 40 years to write this book. Tell us a little bit about the inception of the book, and did it really take you 40 years?
Well, first of all, thank you, everybody, for coming, and Stephanie and Marcy and Rabbi Sydney for arranging all this. It's really wonderful to be here. I know this room. I've been in this room before, and I've heard some really great people, and it's funny to be on this side of the... nice to see so many wonderful faces. Well, it really did take 40 years. Girij and I, my wife who's here, I can't see anybody. There she is over there. My wife of 47 years was there. We had just come back from India, and it's hard even to say this, after we eradicated smallpox, and we were at the University of Michigan. I was a professor, Girij was getting her PhD, and I have a friend, Dan Goleman, who's been here. He wrote Emotional Intelligence. He had lived in the ashram with us, and he tried to get me to archive, memorialize our experience. And, you know, I think really, because we were hippies and he was afraid we'd burned out, he said, write it before you die. I think I just got it under the wire.
I really hope not.
I started writing it when I joined the faculty in 1978, so it's almost 40 years. And it just didn't come. I didn't really want to write about myself. It was hard enough because I was the youngest person on the team, and it was my first job out of medical school. I didn't know anything, and I was working with these amazing people in the smallpox program, and I had been with my guru, and I certainly didn't know anything compared to Neem Karoli Baba. So I didn't feel right about writing that book. And then as I got older, I wanted to memorialize that experience that we had, because in a way it was the common career path of the 60s. You know, you become a radical, then you become a hippie, then you live in a monastery in the Himalayas, then you join the UN. but it also was me, you know, it was like Uspensky's meetings with remarkable people. I can't believe the amazing people I had the good fortune to meet, and I wanted to write about them. And that was sort of what I was doing until Mark Tauber, who I heard might be here. Is Mark here? That's good. I can tell you something nice about him. When Mark Tauber, who's the publisher of Harper One, had a book contract of mine to write something else, and he said, well, that's not going very well. Why don't you write whatever you want to write? And that was about the time that Trump was coming into an ascendancy, and it was a feeling of a combination of, I've seen this movie before, I've been here before. It's like the 60s, fighting for civil rights with Martin Luther King or fighting against the war in Vietnam. But it's also, I wanted to put in writing a proof point, an alternative truth. I wanted to put in writing a story about a time when we were not just dumb, incompetent people relegated to our silos. White people here, black people here, women there, men there, Jews here, Christians there. I wanted to write about a time it didn't have to be like that. When Jews and Christians and Muslims and Hindus and Buddhists and Shinto and Jains and animists all worked together. When you could come into one of our meetings and look at all the faces and it would be as if God had come and organized them by color, and it looked like the faces of a rainbow. When we could work together at a time when Russia and the United States had 40,000 nuclear weapons pointed at each other, and we could bury 40,000 hatchets and work together and look in the same direction. It was like St. Xavier wrote, true love consists not so much in looking in each other's eyes passionately as in looking together to the far horizon in the same direction with ardor. And we look together to a world that could be free of this one horrible disease. And people of all faiths, doctors from 170 countries, searched every house in India. We made over 2 billion house calls, an army of 150,000 people. And I want to offer that as an alternative reality to the reality of what's coming out of the White House now, that we have to fight against each other. We have to corral ourselves into little groups and stay in our own corners. Because it's not like that. It hasn't been like that before, and it doesn't have to be like that in the future.
Well, that's all I need to hear. That is, I like the way that you say alternative reality. As we've all heard over and over again, we're in a post-truth era. But I would hope that it's not just an alternative reality, but it is an emerging reality.
In the 60s that I grew up in had a different definition of alternative reality.
Mm-hmm. Yes, yes. Well, I was born in the 60s, so I can kind of relate to that in the diaper way.
I just read about it.
But the idea that it could be a path for the future, I want to bring us back to the beginning of the book, where you talk a little bit about where you came from. And we're both from the Midwest, Michigan, Chicago, and that sense of Yiddishkeit that you and Girija, who was Elaine at that time, that you grew up with. And for me, it was fascinating because this is a very Jewish book to me. For somebody who has lived in many parallel universes of spirituality, as a rabbi reading it, I kept getting brought in by your Jewish text, by the stories from the Torah, the stories from the Talmud, from the stories from your family. So give us a little picture of the trajectory of the pre-ashram Jewish kid from Michigan and that trajectory, how you got from that place to at least the beginning of that emerging spiritual seeker.
Well, first of all, Girija was Elaine Feldman, and now she's Girija Brilliant. And those who think that's an upgrade, please let her know that you're... Nothing against Feldman or Elaine. She was 15 and I was 16, and we met at an AZA BBG mixer. That's the truth. That's hard. I mean, that's the actual most probable thing in the whole improbable in the whole book. So I grew up in a in an immigrant community. My dad was an immigrant. I'm a first generation American. My dad was born in Belarus, as he would say, halfway between Minsk and Pinsk. And of course, it was stamped Russia on his passport. Girija's father was born in Slovakia, the back end of Czechoslovakia. My grandfather on my mother's side was a tailor, and my grandfather on my father's side was a bricklayer. I often wondered if in that enthusiasm that Russian Jews had for naming themselves aspirationally, if being a bricklayer, he hadn't chosen a stone that was the best stone, a diamond, which in Russian, of course, is brilliant, and maybe that's how we got our name. I don't know. It was Brilliantov, we think. And then at Ellis Island, it became Brilliant Diamond, which answers the question that everybody always asks me, did you really take that name for yourself as an honorific? And I didn't. I grew up in a community where all the houses looked pretty much the same. They would have 1,500 square feet, 1,600 square feet. I was the first person in my family on either side to graduate high school, certainly go to college. We're not sure about the graduating high school. I went to the University of Michigan only because I won a math test and a scholarship. Otherwise, we wouldn't have been able to afford my going to the University of Michigan. And I went to a school which, years later, there's a friend of mine here from Mumford High School as well, over there. And years later, people call Mumford High School Pink and Blue Jew U. Undoubtedly because it was painted pink and blue. And what, 85% of the kids who went there graduated with postdoctoral degrees or some ridiculous number. So I'm only a product of public schools. You tell that to Betsy DeVos.
We will.
You know, I've lectured at Harvard and Oxford and Royal Society, and I always start off by saying it's nice to be at a school that couldn't quite make it as a public school. But, you know, we were really lucky. The immigrant stream was alive and well in northwestern Detroit, Michigan. We lived just this side of 7 Mile Road. You all heard that 8 Mile Road is the boundary, so we were at least 1 mile safe. We didn't live in the suburbs and brag later on that we were from Detroit. We were really from Detroit. And the kids that I went to school with were the children of dentists or small businessmen. It was a mostly Jewish community, but there were Arab Americans, there were Armenians, there were Catholics, and every once in a while somebody had blonde hair, not very often. And we all walked to school. I remember going to Bagley and then Post and then Mumford. I still get letters from people today who read that book and say, I went to Post, or we got beat up together, you know, something like that. I'll tell you one vivid memory, which is, and I spent a lot of time lately at the University of San Francisco and Santa Clara with a bunch of Jesuits, and I really think they're Jews, you know, I mean, it just feels like the same. But I always tell the story that the thing that brought my community together was baseball. We learned how to multiply and divide by Al Kaline's batting average. And we would take it to four digits. And we were passionate about baseball. It wasn't Temple Israel that I belonged to. It wasn't bar mitzvah or confirmation class that I got kicked out of. Happy to explain why. I wasn't guilty.
It's always the rabbi or the cantor's fault.
Well, actually, I think I told you 2 years ago there was the annual meeting of the United States Reform Rabbis that they had in San Francisco, and I was invited to be the keynote speaker, and I began by saying I was kicked out of confirmation class. And then the person who had introduced me got up afterwards and said, why is it that our last five speakers were all kicked out of confirmation class? But we all wanted to play baseball, and the best diamond, in fact, the only diamond that we could go to was at the University of Detroit, which was a Jesuit school. And so we would wait until it was quiet there and then climb over the fence, bring our bats, we'd play baseball there, and then we'd always get chased out by a Jesuit with a Cossack, you know. And it was pretty good, you know. I was pretty slow, but we managed to get over the fence, and one day the Jesuit came out, and under the Cossack, he had a baseball bat, and he was chasing us. And whenever I do this at a Jesuit school, I always tell them, that was my recurring nightmare for 30 years, waking up being
chased by a Jesuit priest and a Cossack chasing you with a
baseball bat. Mm-hmm. But that was, Mumford was amazing. We had two PhDs teaching us, a woman named Edna Kovac, who was my professor of, my teacher of German. Oh, I brought German back into a Jewish high school right after the Second World War. I was weird, but I did that, yeah. I pushed really hard. She was my Latin teacher, and then when we brought German back into the school, she taught German as well.
So you were a revolutionary from...
The right word off, they used wasn't revolution. They used idiot or
troublemaker.
Yeah.
Right. Mm. Well, from this vantage point, at this point in your life, it looks like you were a revolutionary. And, you know, you're describing, you know, what...
But I was Aleph Gadol of the Louis D. Brandeis chapter of AZA. I was pretty conventional, as a little bit, maybe.
Let's hold to that idea of you were a little bit conventional, at least at that point in your life. But you didn't go the way that most kids who grew up going to BBYO or going to a predominantly Jewish high school went, at least not after. I mean, you did fulfill the most Jewish parent's dream. You went
became
to
a doctor.
You became a doctor, and then you went towards the left. Tell us about that, because in the book, that was, you know, it was a very important part of your life as you left that trajectory.
I remember that when I was bar mitzvahed the next day, which was a Monday after the bar mitzvah, there was, and we were at Mumford, but there was a gathering taking place downtown Detroit at the, I think it was the Second Baptist Church on Woodward Avenue, and it was to join the NAACP. And it seemed to my young mind that all the kids, all the cool kids, went out of school and went down to the Baptist Church and signed up to join the NAACP. So I don't think it was just me. I think it was something about the Jewish experience that identified with the African-American struggle. And not completely, we shouldn't fool ourselves, but enough that it was safe to do it, because I don't remember being all that courageous a kid. And I remember, must have been 100 kids, I was in a class of 600, who went down and signed up to join the NAACP at 13 years old. That's weird and wonderful, and it's part of the tikkun olam that we are ingrained in. I think we are. I think all of us, that whatever, we're left-wing Jews, right-wing Jews, pro-Israel, concerned about Israel, we're reform, we all have this thing written in us of tikkun olam, to heal the broken world, to make the world a better place. It's part of our Jewishness. It may only be aspirationally part of our Jewishness, but we don't laugh at somebody when they say, I want to make the world a better place. We want to be like them. You know, we want to eat what they eat, drink what they like, because we know that that's part of who we are. And that the 13-year-old kids in this Jewish high school in Detroit, Michigan, felt it enough to join the NAACP, I think that's more about our culture than it is about me. I think it's more about, you know, thousands of years of history than it is about Mumford High School, as much as that was an amazingly wonderful experience.
I'd love to support your notion of being the average Jewish guy in Michigan, but I don't know any other guys who wrote a book like this, so I have to push you a little bit and say, I agree with you that, you know, the civil rights movement, the Jews and African Americans had something going, and we still do, and we still need to more and more. But there was a point at which that I think many Jews struggle about their spirituality, their spiritual path, and what you do on the ground. And that's where, I mean, any other Jews in here eradicated smallpox. Right? That's what I want you to talk about a little bit, is just that that was, in this account, this spiritual search that you and Girja found yourselves on, and it wasn't a comfortable search for you at first. You got a message from your guru that told you to do something that was very much in line with your medical training, but seemed impossible. It seemed absolutely, almost ludicrous or impossible. As you're reading this and you're thinking, I was thinking, well, was this guy playing with you? Sending you over and over and over again to the World Health Organization and saying, you're going to be a part of eradicating smallpox. And at what point in yourself as a spiritual seeker did those two paths of being a doctor, being a healer, and having that belief from a human being who had divinity in him, did that merge into a possibility?
Well, I think the way we got there, I think, you know, informed my state of mind. I had delivered a baby on Alcatraz when the Native Americans took over, and then I guess because of that, I was offered a role as a doctor in a Warner Brothers movie. This is what you want me to talk about. So I played a young doctor in a Warner Brothers movie, a terrible Warner Brothers movie called Medicine Ball Caravan, where I met Wavy Gravy and the Hog Farm, and Girish and I joined the Hog Farm commune. And then we traveled from a Pink Floyd concert in Canterbury through Europe and Turkey. We lived in Turkey and Iran, Iraq, Afghanistan, Pakistan, India, Nepal. We walked. This is the 1970s. And I should have mentioned that on the movie caravan, we were paid every Friday with a 1955 paneled station wagon. And when Freddie Weintraub opened up the back and We had a choice of being paid out of the box on the left side or the right side, and the right side was money. And the left side, you could choose between LSD and hash. So maybe it was those 100 days of LSD that might have had something to do.
You know, That's what I was talking about.
I'm just thinking about that. Yeah, I mean, it was a long time ago, and LSD was still legal at that time. I hasten to add. Did I mention that it was legal still then? And then, you know, we lived in these incredibly exotic places with two buses, 40 young people, psychedelic painted buses. I do want to say that every place we went in Afghanistan or Iraq or India, if you went into a Hindu village, in the center of the village, there would be a little temple, and there might be a picture of Vishnu or Shiva. If it was a Muslim village, there'd be a picture of Mecca. If it was a Buddhist village, there'd be a picture of, or an idol, a statue of Buddha. And if it was a Christian village, there'd be a cross or a picture of Mary. And not all the time, but, you know, one out of two out of 10 times, right next to that image of Buddha or that picture of Mecca or that cross or that picture of Vishnu, there'd be a picture of John F. Kennedy. And that's in the heart, the center, the most sacred part of that village, there'd be a picture of John F. Kennedy. And that was because America represented something, all of us represented something aspirational. Now we know we had Japanese internment camps. We know we launched nuclear weapons. We know what we did to Native Americans. We know we had our stuff. But aspirationally, in those villages, when we rolled in with two psychedelic buses and we looked like Martians, we were treated so lovingly and so kind, and in the center of their world was a picture of our president. It's going to be a long time before there'll be a picture of another American president in the center of those villages. And I lament the fact that my kids can't make that, and we can't meet people in the place that we met them then. And so that was part of my consciousness when Girija insisted that we go to this ashram of Neem Karoli Baba, and she dragged me kicking and screaming because I didn't want to go to an ashram where there was a fat old man with a blanket on, and there were all these idols, and people were touching his feet. That was enough of my Jewishness that I didn't want to touch anybody's feet or worship idols. And after we'd been there for a year, and I changed my mind about all that because of the things that I saw happen. And I'll tell you a couple of those stories. Mm-hmm. Is that
wonderful?
So when Girija got me to go to the ashram, and this is the ashram that Baba Ram Das wrote about in Be Here Now, so those of you who are of a certain age will remember that. When we first walked in there, I got the feeling that my wife had been captured by a cult. And I started thinking about, where do you find a deep programmer in the Himalayas? And I thought that the scene around him was strange. All these young Westerners, most of them Jewish. Mm-hmm. Most of the Americans who came to see Maharaji, as we call him, were Jewish. But even though I thought the scene was strange, I was really disappointed when he didn't say, "Larry, I've been waiting for you." In fact, he didn't say anything. And after about a week of that, that added on to the scene around him. I was persuaded that it was not the scene for me. And Girija and I had a really tough conversation, because if that was not the right place for me and that was the right place for her, and if I was going to leave, it meant ending something I didn't want to end because I loved her so much. And it was because of that that I stayed, as much as anything else. But then I went out one day, and I went out on the lake, Lake Nanital, and I was so despondent. For the first time in my adult life, I prayed. I didn't know how to pray. I mean, I remembered my bar mitzvah lessons. I could say my mafter, but I didn't really know what it meant. I could also say omani pani hung, but I didn't know what that meant. I had all the, you know, top 40 hits of the spiritual world of the 60s. I could recite them, but I didn't know what they meant. But I began to really pray and ask God for a sign that I was in the right place and that Girish and I would stay together, even if she was still Elaine Feldman to me. But I didn't get a sign. I didn't need a big rainbow in the sky. I would have been content with a little rainbow in an oil slick on the water, but nothing. And I came back that night and told Girish that I was going to leave, and she knew I was depressed. And So next morning I packed, we separated our orange backpacks, and she said, "Are you going to say goodbye to him?" And I said, "Yeah, I'm from Detroit. My dad told me to be polite. I'll go say goodbye to him." And we went down that morning, and the ashram was such that there was one wooden bench that Neem Karoli Baba Maharaji would sit on. And there were these doors behind him, and he would come out like an opera singer, you know, like Loretta Young, we used to say, and just take the stage. And the villagers had taken, and on that bench they had written out a mandala in the name of God, Ram, with flowers and apples and fruits. And it was a beautiful rainbow-colored mandala. And one of the apples had fallen on the ground, and so the name of God was incomplete. And I knew that the name of God should never be incomplete. So I reached down to pick up the apple, thinking that I was going to complete the name of God, and Maharaji burst out, jumped up, put his foot on my hand and pinned me down there. And this was the worst thing I could imagine. I didn't want to touch his feet, and now not only was I touching his feet, I couldn't get up. And it seemed like he weighed about a ton, and my hand was pinned there. And he looked down at me, and he said, "You weren't here yesterday." And for one second, I had this, you know, 13-year-old thought, at least he noticed. He said, "You weren't here yesterday." And he asked me all these questions about where I was. And after he had gone through this interrogation, he looked at me, and his eyes were blazing, and he said, "Were you talking to God?" And that was it. My spine started tingling. The air felt different. The colors seemed more vibrant. I could barely move. And then he started slapping me across the face and holding me and hugging me. And he said, "Did you ask God for a sign?" And that just wasn't fair. It was like, you know, my motor couldn't keep up with the input. My brain couldn't keep up with it. And then he just looked at me, and it looked like he just loved me with all of my imperfections and all of my faults in a way that was totally forgiving. And I looked at him and I saw someone who loved everybody in the world. And then I had this other crazy thought. It was, he should love everybody in the world. Every rabbi should love everybody in the world. Every priest should love everybody in the world. Every guru should love everybody in the world. But what got me and hooked me was at that moment, I loved everybody in the world. And I didn't know that this machine came equipped with a button to love everybody in the world. And that's the experience that we had every day. And it was different each day. After I had had that, all the other people in the ashram, all the other Americans, mostly Jewish, did I mention? Mostly Jewish, came around and hugged me. Girija hugged me, and that was my initiation. It wasn't like I'd read in the books that your initiation is you repeat a mantra 30 times, you stand on one foot. It was that. It was that experience of the guru's grace, of the teacher's grace. If I was being intellectual and Jewish, I would say it felt like the way Martin Buber wrote about the Baal Shem Tov. And Maharaji always felt to me a little bit like I hoped that I would have felt around the Baal Shem Tov or St. Francis. But that's what it was like. And so when he said a year later, out of the blue, well, not exactly out of the blue, I was trying to meditate, I was off in a corner, and Maharaji was always giving away fruit as, they call it prasad, as gifts. But every time I would sit to meditate, he would take an apple and throw it at my testicles. As if to say, meditation's really good, you should meditate, but have I got something for you? And then he called me and Girija and asked us to come sit with him. And he said to me, Dr. America, because that was the name he had given me. Dr. America, how much money do you have? And that, you know, there's a whole other channel down which that goes. And I said, I have $500. He said, $500. You're lying. How much money do you have back in America? And I thought about the time I'd worked as an emergency room doctor, and I said, I have $500 in America too. And then he started to chant. You have to understand that everything was funny around him. Everything was, he was a comedian. Everything was a joke. He turned every single moment into something funnier than you ever thought anything could ever be. And he started to chant, $500 here, $500 there, you are no doctor. Which is exactly what my mother had said to me. You can't make any money? You're not a real doctor. And $500 here, $500 there, you are no doctor, you are no doctor. This is all in Hindi. And then he switched to English. You are no doctor, you are no doctor, U-N-O doctor, United Nations Organization. Dr. America is going to become a United Nations doctor. And you're going to work to help eradicate smallpox. Because this horrible disease is going to be lifted off of the back of humanity by God, who as a gift to humanity will conquer this one form of suffering.
And then it wasn't funny anymore, it was real.
I didn't understand it. I thought, does he want me to give him a shot?
Mm-hmm.
I mean, it was just so improbable. We kept asking the translator, what did he mean, what did he mean? And then they repeated it, and he repeated it. And then he looked at us and says, now, go. And so we took a taxi and a jeep and a rickshaw and a bus and went down to New Delhi, which was about 15 or 16 hours, and walked into the WHO office, still wearing my ashram clothes with a hair down to the middle of my back and a beard down to my... And I walked in. Mrs. Boyer was the receptionist, and she said, what are you here for? I said, my guru who lives in the Himalayas said God is going to help eradicate smallpox, and I'm here to work with you. How are you? And they kicked me out. And then we went back to the ashram, the same thing. And Maharaji said, did you get your job yet? And I said, no. He said, go back. And we went back. And after we'd gone back about 6, 7, 8, 9, 10 times, I finally got smart enough to begin to trim my hair and borrowed a sport coat and walked in. And I was, think on a 15 times, the 15th or so, I walked in and there was another American there. First time I'd seen an American. And he said, who are you? I said, oh, I'm Larry Brilliant. I'm a doctor. I live in the Himalayas. My guru said that God is going to help eradicate smallpox. This is his gift to humanity. Who are you? He said, I'm D.A. Henderson. I'm the head of the Global Smallpox Program in Geneva. We don't have a program in India, but it's nice of you to come. Guru, you say? And we talked, and he said, well, look, there is no program. Mrs. Gandhi hasn't allowed us to have one in India yet. But I'm here, you're there. How about if we go in the cafeteria? I'll interview you. I'll put something in the record if something happens. So he interviewed me. And then 10 years later, after I had been working in smallpox and had kind of risen up and was running the program when the adults were away, he asked me to go back from the University of Michigan to New Delhi and put all the records in an archive and put them on microfilm. And I did, and I confess I cheated. And I looked at the interview he had done of me 10 years earlier in the records. And it said, I have today met a young man named Larry Brilliant. He says he's a doctor. He doesn't look like one. He says his guru in the Himalayas has sent him here. We don't have a program, but we would never have a job for him anywhere. He appears to have gone native. And every publication, every book I ever wrote until halfway through this one, D.A. Henderson proofread every word and helped me. And he was one of the great ones that I got to work with until he passed away. We went to his memorial service about 8 weeks ago. I want to say one thing. I got to work with the giants in public health. D.A., who got the Presidential Medal of Freedom, Bill Fagey, who took me to see my first case of smallpox, was the head of CDC, became the head of CDC, the head of the Carter Center, and was the guy who whispered in Bill Gates' ear, hey, what about a foundation working on global health? He got the Presidential Medal of freedom. Steno Ježek from Czechoslovakia, who got the Czech medal. Isao Arito got the Japan prize. M.I.D. Sharma, the Padma Shri, this great Indian who adopted me. And Nicole Grasse, who was actually the person who really hired me, who won the French Legion of Honor. These were my bosses. I don't know how I won the lucky draw, but that's what changed me. It made me realize that public health was a spiritual calling, and that my spiritual path was in Tikkun Olam, right back full circle.
Mm-hmm. And you had gone native, and as he said, and it seemed that having gone native, as he called it, actually helped you so much in the eradication of smallpox that not just physically but spiritually the Maharaji was with you, that you would take a picture of him and that you would tell people in villages that that was your guru, and in fact he opened doors for you.
He did. He passed away, he died, just as we were beginning the first All India search in September. That search was 150,000 people going door to door to every house in India. And we had some problems in Bihar and Uttar Pradesh, but Maharaji had written me letters of introduction to the governor of Uttar Pradesh and to Jayaprakash Narayan, who was a Gandhian who was putting in a statewide strike in Bihar. And so I had those physical, not just the metaphysical support, but I had the physical support of Maharaji. And many times when people were skeptical, Indians were skeptical, I have to say that everybody was skeptical that we could eradicate smallpox. My best day, and I had a lot of days when I was crying all day when I would see little babies who had died, and sometimes hundreds of them in a day, and I got mad at God all the time. How could God be such a lousy manager? And reincarnation isn't an adequate answer for children having to die of a disease like smallpox. But my best day was when we had eradicated smallpox. And Nicole Grasse drove to the airport in New Delhi with the tire of a Land Rover in a box, because the head of communicable diseases for WHO, along with everybody else in WHO, said that we would never eradicate smallpox. And this fellow, whose name was Ignatovich, he said that I'm so certain that you will never eradicate smallpox that if you ever would, I will eat the tire of a Land Rover. And I watched as Nicole, we boxed the tire, and Nicole, in her beautiful French script, wrote, "Dear Dr. Ignatovich, as agreed, I am enclosing a tire from a Land Rover, well used, and I'd like you to respond, quoting the bouquet, the texture, and whether you need any condiments. Sincerely yours."
I want to read something that that really struck me from the book, and then I'd like you to tell another story. So you wrote, "Sometimes people say that faith is the opposite of doubt, but I don't think that is true. To me, the opposite of faith is rigid certainty. Doubt is the constant companion of true faith. Like God, it is more verb than noun. Faith is the ride, not the station, as Indians describe it. No one can avoid doubt, skepticism, fear, and uncertainty on the journey to faith if they are honest with themselves. Obstacles are the training ground."
Good editor.
Great writer. Great writer. And you know, in incredible story. And the stories in here literally seem to burst off the pages. And it's kind of, you know, when you're eating something that's just so delicious, you want to prolong it. You don't want to just have it last one meal. I had to really slow down at the end of this book because I saw that it was coming to an end. I didn't, you know, obviously I wanted smallpox eradicated, but I didn't want the journey to end. So I want to thank you for that. And, you know, for a rabbi to read that about faith struck me right in the heart where I think it was supposed to give people the opportunity, no matter what religion they call themselves, to be open to the fact that doubt actually can be an inspiration.
How could you? I mean, we could lie about it, but that's not going to get us where we want to go. I saw, I think, my friend Bill Clemens here, and It reminds me of conversations about the stock market. They say that the stock market climbs a wall of worry. If I mean, I think that faith climbs a wall of worry. And you, the things that you see, you try to square the circle between the problem of suffering in the world, the problem of death, the loss that we have, all of us, every one of us, every house has been touched. As Buddha said, there is not a single house that hasn't been touched by death. And you try to square the circle of the pain of death, the loss of a beloved. And in my case, in India, I would see bodies stacked like cords of wood. We went to a place in Bihar where they told us the rivers didn't run because of all the dead babies, bodies that were thrown in the rivers. And there were rumors of birds of prey flying around with little arms and legs with spots on them. I mean, that's a Hieronymus Bosch painting. That's Dante's Inferno. How can you believe that there is an omnipotent, omniscient, benevolent, merciful God, and there is suffering like that? And that drives you further. Then you have to ask deeper questions. You have to dig deeper. Who's suffering? Who am I who's suffering? What is this life? Is it a training ground, really, for another incarnation? Does the soul really create the guidelines and the circumstances for our next birth? Judaism, in the old days, believed in reincarnation. Many rabbis talk about the perfection of the soul through many different trials. Is that enough, though, to justify this suffering? Is it just a game? How can you not have that dialogue with yourself? And if you arrive at faith and you don't go through that, where have you really arrived? And what Indians say, this idea that it's not the station, it's the ride. That's the same kind of a quizzical answer. It isn't just, I'm going to go, I'm going to get my degree, I'm going to become a doctor or a lawyer, I'm going to, you know, get retirement, and what next? It's not those stations. It's what you do in the spaces in between those plateaus, those accomplishments. It's the conversation you have with your wife, your husband. It's watching your children. It's not the station, it's the ride. And I think that's where God sneaks in. It's like the Leonard Cohen song, there's a crack in everything. That's how the light gets in. And the crack is doubt. The light is God, our faith. And that's how God sneaks in while you're being honest about your doubts, and you're not, you know, you're not phoning it in, you're not faking it. And I had the privilege of watching the worst disease in history, watching children die from that, and you know, just to add to the gruesomeness count, I won't do more of that, but one particular kind of smallpox, hemorrhagic smallpox, that had 100% fatality. Regular smallpox only had 35% fatality. And it had a cruel predisposition for pregnant women. Killed everyone who was pregnant. Like a biblical plague. And in fact, some people say that Sfat, one of the 10 biblical plagues, boils, was smallpox. Some say the boils of Job was smallpox. We don't know. But I got to see that horror and live in it while we stayed in India for the better part of 10 years. And then I got to see the last case of smallpox, the last case of killer smallpox, the last child to be afflicted. And it was done, as I said earlier, by people of every color and every faith working together. How can you stand before the last case of smallpox and doubt for a second that humans are capable of noble feats and that there is a God? It was a mystical experience for me. And it arose through doubt and anger and bewilderment. And I will tell you that, and Girish is here, so it's hard for us to talk about this, but our own son died a few years ago from cancer. He was only 27. And everything I had felt before in spades, I thought, I must be prepared for anything. I mean, look what I've been through. But I collapsed completely. We both did. We still do. And it isn't, you don't go through the stages of doubt and come to a belief in God, get angry at God, come back to a belief, and then never revisit doubt and anger. That's just not how it works. Maybe in fiction, but not in memoir anyway.
Before we invite our audience, who I can see is really ready to ask you their own questions, Rabbi Hillel was asked to teach the entire Torah standing on one foot. So you don't have to stand on one foot. But if I asked you at this point in your life, and I, you know, when we spoke, I said, so what's next for you? You have done so much, and, you know, at this point in your life, I pray to God and all the gods that you have a lot more time on this earth, because you might not consider yourself a guru, but what are you doing on Yom Kippur? what's your Torah? What is the Torah that you can teach us standing on one foot that you have learned through the beauty, through the suffering, through the healing?
On one foot?
Mm-hmm.
Love everybody. I told Rabbi Sidney earlier that the New Testament has four Gospels, and three of them, essentially the Synoptic Gospels, tell the same story. And in the three Gospels, they all have the story of the rabbi who comes to Jesus and asks him, he called him Rabbi. The rabbi coming to Jesus calls Jesus Rabbi, says, Rabbi, what is the highest and the best commandment? And in Matthew and Luke, Jesus is quoted as answering, the highest commandment is this: love the Lord your God with all your heart and all your soul, and your neighbor as yourself. But in Mark, which is supposed to be the oldest of the New Testaments, when Jesus is asked, what is the highest commandment? He responds in Aramaic, in Hebrew. He says, the highest commandment is this: Shema Yisrael Adonai Eloheinu Adonai Echad. It's the only Hebrew in the Old Testament, in the New Testament, which is written in Greek. And I spend a lot of time thinking about what that means. What does Shema Yisrael Adonai Eloheinu Adonai Echad mean? I like the Echad. I like the idea that somehow we are all part of a oneness, a unity. My guru used to say, sub ek. It's shorter, but it means we're all one. When Muslims would come to him, he would say, La ilaha illa Muhammad Rasulullah, or greet them as salam alaikum. He had Muslim students. When Christians would come, he would say Jesus was the best. Hindus of the different kinds, he would, you know, either give him a Vishnu or a Shiva shloka, and Buddhists. And every time he would say sub ek, they're all the same, they're all one, all roads lead home. And I think that's true both spiritually as well as politically. And I think it's something for us to think about in the coming days and in the years, when we will face adversity and we will have to work harder than we've ever worked to keep love in our heart and love everybody, even the people that we're going to have to fight against.
Thank you so much, Larry.
That's beautiful. Ooh, I like that.
So we do have some time now for a few questions.
Starting in the front. I feel on the verge of crying, but when we see so much anger in language, and you say, look to love, how do we respond with love and be responding to them?
So Girij and I were 2 weeks ago in Maui for the Women's March. Now that may sound like what a terrible job, but somebody's got to do it. I mean, we didn't march in Washington. You know, nobody hit us. And it seemed like half of Maui was marching. We were staying with this friend of ours, Ramdas, and at his house he has a what's called a puja table. It's like an altar. And on it he has pictures of all the deities and all the gurus and all the wise men and women. Here's a photograph of Trump. And it's not that he would have voted for Trump, or that he liked Trump, or that he likes anything about Trump, but it was his exercise of trying to show compassion to someone who doesn't show compassion to anyone else. And I'm not there yet. But aspirationally, I want to be there. And that's what I would say. I would say, aspirationally, I want to be there. I want to believe that that we really are all, we're all one, we're all together. I want to say one more thing about smallpox, that my favorite slide when I would give lectures in schools of public health, my favorite slide is a photograph and a list of all the kings and queens and emperors who died of smallpox. And there's two dozen, from Queen Mary to the Aztec deity, the Inca deity, I mean, every king and queen and emperor that you think of who died of smallpox. And it's not my favorite slide because I'm an anti-royalist, although I probably am, but you know, it's my favorite slide because we live in the shadow of Silicon Valley. We live in a land of Medicis. Many of these Medicis are very dear friends of mine. And it's a reminder that no matter how rich and powerful these kings and queens were, they couldn't protect themselves from a simple virus for which there wasn't an antiviral and there wasn't a vaccine. Because we're really all so much the same. And we're really all in it together. It's clear, it's very clear when you're fighting a pandemic or fighting climate change or any of the catastrophic occurrences from water or nuclear weapons. It's clear that we're all in it together. But we forget. So that's my reminder that all the kings and queens who died of smallpox, they couldn't escape it with all their money and all their power. It's not enough to be rich and powerful. This is something that we will have to get out of together. And in this case, as a nation, we're going to have to remind ourselves what the motto is of America. You remember what the motto is? It's on your coins, E pluribus unum. Out of many, one.
Question over here on the right.
Hello, doctor. I'm Dan Smith. We used to play tennis in Marin County many years ago.
Hi, Dan. How are you? Yes, I remember. You used to beat me all the time.
No. You let me win.
Oh, I see. You think that I was letting you win.
In my work with the Plowshares Fund, we've encountered some resistance with respect to philanthropy in Silicon Valley. And there's a reputation that it's very hard to get people who have lots of means to be philanthropic in Silicon Valley. Could you talk about that and
what
your
experience
is?
That's not my experience. I think our billionaires are different than their billionaires. So you know, with Skoll Global Threats, I think we're one of the largest funders to Plowshares, and
yes,
we love Plowshares. You're welcome. I think that if you guys don't know Plowshares, they are one of the most successful organizations working against the proliferation of nuclear weapons. But even more important than that, if anything could be more important than that, they were, and success has 1,000 parents. Plowshares was instrumental in bringing us the Iran nuclear agreement. And they worked to explain how nuclear weapons worked to a Congress that didn't understand it. And it's one of the most successful and effective organizations that I know. I don't think that for the age at which these victims of sudden wealth syndrome find themselves, I don't think that there has ever been a more generous cohort. When you think about how old they are and how new philanthropy is to them, many of them, 40% being immigrants without coming from wealth, I think that it's pretty amazing. And of course, then there are these amazing squared stories like Mark Benioff, who gives $100 million to build a children's hospital in San Francisco. And then when he's reminded that he's just built a hospital for the richest kids in the world. And he looks at Oakland, he says, I'll give $100 million there too. You have these acts of amazing generosity. Almost everybody in Silicon Valley gave large sums of money in the double-digit millions from that community to stop Ebola. There wasn't a single company in Silicon Valley that didn't help fight against Ebola with volunteers or money or technology. No, I actually think that we are lucky that these mostly young people, for their age, are incredibly generous. And I don't know if you know about the giving pledge that Bill Gates and Warren Buffett put together. I'm actually going to be speaking there next week. And these are people who are among the 500 wealthiest people in the world, all billionaires. And at least half of them have agreed to give half of their money to philanthropy. I think that it's unusual to find that degree of universal generosity. Now, how that money is used, whether that is charity to give away out of a sense of obligation, or whether that money is used strategically to conquer the great threats that we face in the world today, or especially the one that looks like an oxymoron if it's coming from rich people, is to deal with economic inequality. I think that we live in a little bit of a golden age of philanthropy and kind of in a kind of golden region right now. Let's see what happens over the next few years, and we'll play tennis and talk about it.
Thank you. Question over here on the right.
Thank you. I'm Marcia Rosenbaum, known Ram Dass for many years as well. And I'm curious about the impact of psychedelics on your own evolution.
Yeah, I'm curious about that too. You know, I keep waiting to forget it. And maybe that would be proof, you know, that it ruins your mind. I have to say, I lost so many friends to drugs, good friends who didn't get lucky like I did, or Girija did. I wouldn't ever want to be a data point for how good drugs are. But for me, I never would have been open to any of the spiritual experiences that I had if I hadn't had drugs. So I have this kind of, I hope it's a very prudent view of them, which is that they've helped a lot of people to open their hearts, and they've killed a lot of people. And so I can't recommend them, but I can't, in honesty, say that if you're talking about psychedelics, now we're not talking about opioids, which are terrible drugs. Opioids are killing more people in the United States today than all the car accidents together and many forms of cancer. There's an epidemic of opioids, far more than we've ever had before. If we're talking about methamphetamine and speed, it's not a cliche, speed kills. But if we're talking narrowly about the class of psychedelic drugs that would have psilocybin in it and mescaline, for me that was a good experience, a wonderful experience. It was an act of worship. It wasn't a drug experience. And I can't say that I've done that in 30 years, and maybe I'm making all this up, maybe the drugs have ruined my memory so much that I remember it very warmly, but that's the way I remember it.
Question right here in the center.
Oh yeah, thank you so much, Dr. Brilliant. This was so powerful, and what a compelling conversation. I was wondering if you could talk a little bit more about Silicon Valley and, you know, the Chan Zuckerberg initiative, for example, where they want to end all disease this century, what advice you would have for them. I was also wondering if you could just tell us what your fondest wish is for your book and how we could all help.
Well, I'll do the second first, if I can. I hope that the book will actually be, first of all, I'm so grateful, it's been so wonderful to have this book out there. I get dozens, sometimes even more than dozens of emails every day from people who've just finished reading it. It's like little hits of dopamine, you know. that's the drug that I like the most. I just getting these little bits of love by email, and I didn't expect it. I thought the book would be too difficult for people because it was, you had to kind of look at all these Sanskritized Hindi words and then all these medical words. And people tell me that it's not that difficult. That makes me feel really good. So my hope is that it continues offering an alternative view of who we are or can be at our best as human beings when we work with people who don't look like us in order to conquer a disease that doesn't affect us, but affects poor people. And we do it out of a sense of honor. I hope that that's what we're reminded of. So, as far as Silicon Valley, I was the first executive director of Google.org. I'm on the board of Salesforce.org. So I kind of live a little bit in that world. I think the Chan Zuckerberg initiative is sensational. I think it is, when all is said and done, a young entrepreneur who's trying to extrapolate from this amazing success of going from idea to billions of people using your product to thinking that that money that he made, more than 50% of which he's giving to charity, that money that he's made, actually he said he's giving all of his money away, but that money will be used to help us conquer diseases. It's just beginning. I was at the announcement. Bill Gates came to give him his blessing. It was really very touching and very sweet to see Bill Gates there kind of anointing and blessing the Chan and Zuckerberg, the Chan Zuckerberg initiative. No, I'm really bullish on that kind of private sector philanthropy. It remains to be seen how strategic and how clever that's all going to be. You have to remember that philanthropy as we know it just became 100 years old 2 years ago with the 100-year anniversary of the Rockefeller Foundation. This is kind of a new thing. I mean, noblesse oblige is old, but taking your money and putting it in another vehicle, getting strangers to be the boards of directors in order to do good things after you're long gone, that's a new kind of thing. And I think Silicon Valley is going to take that and take it to the next level. I'm particularly optimistic about what Zuckerberg is doing and Benioff.
Last question is down here in the front.
Hi, Dr. Brilliant. I know you from SEVA Foundation and all the wonderful concerts that SEVA does, but I haven't heard you talk a little bit about your involvement with SEVA and what all they've done, eradicating a lot of blindness in third world countries and that type of thing. It's a wonderful organization, and thank you very much.
Thank you. I'd love to talk about SEVA. I do want to just finish up on that last question because I started talking about, you know, using your money not just by giving a lot of it away, but using it well and wisely. And the person that I know who does the best job of that is Jeff Skoll. And Jeff has started the Skoll Foundation, which works to create social entrepreneurship. Jeff was the first president of eBay. He took his money, put $1 billion into a foundation when he was still quite young. And so far that foundation has given away 100 grants of $1.5 million each, so that's $150 million, just to entrepreneurs who are starting nonprofit organizations. He also started a movie company, which is called Participant Media, won the Oscar last year for Spotlight, and has done some amazing, wonderful movies. Just came out with Inconvenient Sequel, the follow-up to Inconvenient Truth, the second round with Al Gore. So there are 100 different ways, and of course he started Skoll Global Threats Fund, that I chair, which works on pandemics and climate change and nuclear weapons and water and Middle East peace. So there's just a lot of different ways to handle that. And in a way, that does bring us to SEVA. When smallpox was eradicated and Girij and I went back to the University of Michigan, our home university, we stayed in touch with the people who had worked with us in India to eradicate smallpox. And I kind of fantasized like mountain climbers that have climbed the first time Mount Everett. You want to climb it again. You want to do something else again. So we had eradicated the first disease in history. We were feeling pretty happy and maybe a little proud of ourselves. And we wanted to do something like that again. So we kept talking about what would we do. And Girish and I wrote an article about our experiences in India. And people started sending us money in the mail. We got $20,000. $5,000 came from Steve Jobs, who had lived with us, lived in India, had gone to the same ashram, and had now started this strange computer company that I didn't think would go very far. Actually, in showing how smart I was and prescient, I still remember trying to talk Steve out of this company, Apple, and try to get him to become the executive director of the Seva Foundation. I told him that blindness was a growth industry and these computers wouldn't go anywhere. But we gathered all the people we'd written about in that article to a retreat center outside of Ann Arbor, Michigan. And we had a kind of Talmudic debate about how do you do good in the world? What should we do? What is strategic philanthropy? If we're going to do something after smallpox, what's it going to be? And I wanted to take on diarrhea, which was the, and still is, one of the largest killers of children. And the only person in that group who agreed with me was Wavy Gravy. And he said, that's a great idea. I'll do a benefit concert to end diarrhea. We'll call that concert No Shit. Everybody else wanted to do blindness. So we created an organization that would work on blindness, and I'm proud to tell you that now, 35 years plus later, SAVA's projects and partners have given back sight to more than 4 million blind people. And again, SAVA was never a religious organization, but it was a spiritually motivated, is still a spiritually motivated organization. But once again, Jews, Muslims, Sufis, we had one nun, lots of Catholics, Protestants, Muslims, Hindus, Buddhists. It's okay, we can gather together from people of all faiths and we can do really wonderful things.
I think that actually was the last question. And we are going to give people an opportunity to do what many people came here to do, which is to get their own signed book of Sometimes Brilliant. And I have to say, if you haven't read it, buy one for yourself. And I do not get a commission on this. Buy one for somebody who is feeling a lack of hope in their own personal life or about this world, because that's what I got from this book, Larry, is there's still a lot of hope. But it does have to come from an open heart that's full of love. So we appreciate you and we thank you.
That it comes from you and means all the world to me. Come here.